Good evening, I'm Andrew Scott here from Proactive Investors. Look, thanks very much indeed for your time tonight. A record number of you signing in, registering for this event, and honestly, no surprise given the lineup we've got tonight. S4 Capital's Sir Martin Sorrell, Ray Gibbs, he's joining us from planarTECH. We've also got Gabriele Cerrone from Tiziana Life Sciences, and also tonight, Cathal, Friel from Open Orphan. Now, usual format, 20 minutes thereabouts of presentation, discussion, talking about the business. That'll be followed by 10 minutes of your questions. So make sure you get those questions. And can't promise that we'll have the chance to put all of those to these companies. We'll do our absolute best, but can't guarantee. So make sure you get those questions in as we're progressing through the presentations. Don't forget, this presentation, in all its entirety, that'll be available afterwards on the Proactive Investors website, proactiveinvestors.co.uk. First up tonight, Mr. Ray Gibbs from planarTECH. Now, they're in the business of graphene. I spoke to him fairly recently on Proactive. They're also looking at other 2D materials. They're already making sales. They're generating revenues. And they're in the middle of a successful fundraising on the CEDARS platform. Their customer list includes the University of Manchester's Graphene Engineering Innovation Centre plus Stanford University, that's just to name two. And Ray's with us this evening to tell us a bit more about the business, what their plans are, and how the fundraising's going. Ray, over to you.
Oh, thank you very much, Andrew, and welcome everybody. You are right, there's quite a lot of people on today, which is excellent. Hopefully, yes, here we go. So I'm Ray Gibbs. I'm the chairman of planarTECH, and it's a private UK company, unlike the other three companies that are listed. And we are dealing with two-dimensional, very thin materials, graphene and other related advanced materials themselves. So really, what are we around? What are we about? Well, the company was formed in 2014. It's in the UK. It's very small. It's got 5 to 6 people. And we supply a range of bespoke systems into a number of research institutions around the globe. There are 65 of these locally, internationally at the moment. We've raised about revenue of about 5 million over that period of time. And we've got really a highly respected systems across the piece in number of research institutions like the Cambridge, who've taken 3 to date already. So What we're about, you can see there, planarTECH's chief executive is on the left-hand side, that's Patrick Franz. And we are in the process of raising £500,000 to support growth and expansion on the Seeders platform. To date, we have 199 investors, maybe 200 after today, and 205,000 already pledged. As you can see, we're a global business for a very small company, a global business. The prime drivers are basically in Asia, Europe, and North America. North America's driven by the desire for semiconductors, and in the European sphere of activity, the graphene flagship, which is an EU-focused project, which is spending about €1 billion a year for 10 years. It's going to be extended. That's developed a number of applications for us across a range of Max Planck's institutes and many others. And Asia in particular is beginning to grow quite quickly because what we produce is stuff on an electronics platform. So many of you would have heard of graphene. It's a wonder material. I'm involved in it since 2010. It's actually 19 years or 18 years or 15 years young going down. But effectively, most of the applications were driven by graphitic based material to start with. That was where it was discovered by the Nobel laureates in Manchester. But now we're getting to the stage where other applications are coming on board, like sports sciences, sensor materials, composites. We're seeing a lot of things. There's basically a Ford Mustang that's got dispersion capabilities to manage heat under the bonnet. Mobile phone operators are using this a lot now. And in the sporting arena, we've seen sports shoes, we've seen tennis rackets, and even a golf ball, believe it or not. So graphene is becoming of age, and we've got a range of different materials in these sectors to come to market. So what are we doing? We've got this continued aspect of growth. planarTECH is effectively a system supplier initially, and all of the businesses that buy our systems are institutions, and they only pay when the system is actually received on site, which creates cash flow from a capital perspective. That's why we're capital raising. But if we look at it, we're going to look to continue supplying R&D systems across the piece, raising beyond 1 million a year, maybe growing even further, because we've got such a fantastic install base. And we have missed out sales due to lack of capital. We're also seeing now commercial activities from several customers across the whole area, primarily in Asia, I might say, where we're targeting another 16 units over 5 years, raising another 5 to 6 million of sales, maybe more from that perspective. And the ASP is an average selling price of around £400,000 each. We're also seeing a range of companies now coming to us looking for commercial applications of these single layer sheets of graphene, which is a very new phenomenon, because if you'd asked me that 2 or 3 years ago, I'd say CVD, chemical vapor deposition material, is not really appropriate for the market. It's too expensive. It's no longer that at all, and it's becoming of age in that respect. So here we have a route to market that we're going to do, the existing businesses, the continued growth that we're expecting to see, leveraging on the back of our existing supply side into all of these research institutes to give us a great vision on what's coming forward. And I want to talk to you about some new markets. So if we look at where we currently are today, the CVD equipment market and applications is massive. Not in our space. We're in a very niche marketplace, I might add, and we're dealing with a range of different applications now, from electronics, digital, which is fueling CVD growth, particularly in Asia, as I said before. And the solar panel industry is using single layer sheets of graphene to enhance their performance in the OPV markets themselves. Interestingly as well, is we're seeing a lot of sensors being driven, not surprisingly, trying to find an ability to understand where we are with COVID-19 at the moment because of the sensitivity of the graphene themselves. So looking at this, we see that Asia is actually about 50% of the whole of the CVD market at the moment, driven by electronics. We've now set ourselves up in Thailand because that's one of the areas of great growth in the Asian market. The the basic business themselves is actually all about equipment, but I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about beyond graphene. So there's been some recent trends to take other two-dimensional materials, very, very thin materials, into a range of applications from the research institutions. For those chemically driven by you, MOS2, molybdenum disulfide, has a range of applications for the semiconductor industry, which is very important for electronics and also for the American markets themselves. And we're seeing a lot of applications driven by the institutions, the research society asking for this product. So here we go. There's this business is in Thailand. We've got actually, this is a system actually sitting in Thailand. It's one of the largest we've got. It can generate a significant amount of volume of pure graphene at the moment. There's another one being built today, and actually we would like to fund that. So that's one of the reasons why we're raising some money. But beyond that, if we can get to each one of these selling systems full on 24/7, which it can do, it will raise £3 million worth of turnover a year for commercial applications. And we do have two industrial contracts which were secured, one of which is in the petrochemical industry. Can't talk about that too much, but they're very interested in taking graphene and using hydrocarbons to make this material. So in terms of industrial scale applications and graphene themselves, this is just a typical example for one company that would take a system from us and use it just for its own purposes. You can see that from a cash cost of about just under 400,000, they can generate significant amounts of bottom line gross profit for their own use and activities. And what is interesting is this does away with a misnomer that graphene is a very expensive commodity, because it actually isn't in volume. So what we're looking at here is, and this is actually a real life customer we've quoted for at the moment, they want to put the coating of graphene on 400,000 pieces of copper-based product per annum. And we're seeing more and more of this happening all the time. Good news. So just something very quickly about our project pipeline. This tends to indicate that we're going forward with an increasing bow wave of responses. And by the way, the COVID-19 has not stopped that. We're still getting inquiries. We're still delivering product. I think the one from Poland is going out next week. We've got a number of activities that are driven by making things happen. Don't be misled by the very small one there. That's for spare parts. But in essence, we've got a lot there. And there's also one more that's come on stream in the last 10 days in Singapore, which is a multi-lock system. And the sum of money involved could be close on seven figures, which is a very exciting development. And that's for next year. So rushing quickly through, how are we going to use the money that we're going to get from the Cedars campaign? We're going to use it for working capital. I said that we've got cash that is constrained by having to ship the capital equipment before we get paid. We do need some service and support to help us make that happen, because we're a global business with 5 to 6 people. It's not quite so easy to do. And we do want to actually put a dedicated production system for increased demand of a range of opportunities that are coming our way now. And then also we've got some ideas about what we want to do in R&D research and development processes at the moment. Just to say, have we got any competitors in the market? There are some, but they tend to be focused on some bigger systems and some bigger outputs. And we're really in a very, very strong niche position. And from a graphene perspective, it's one of the systems is based in the Graphene Engineering Innovation Center, as Andrew said, and by dint of the fact I work there on a regular basis, I know that piece of equipment is being used significantly at the moment on growing commercialization projects. So this is a very broad look at the five-year revenue forecast, and you can see that systems and services are still there. They're going to grow, but really it's all about new products. So for me, here's a bit of an exciting new challenge for people looking at what graphene can do. They've heard all about it, and we're actually seeing some real life examples of this happening in the marketplace today. So two things. We've actually signed an agreement recently to put graphene into armor plating through a company in Thailand, which is why we're setting up there to market these products. They are basically already certified, they're available. And from making an announcement on Proactive and various other sites, we've already received very strong indications from a German company wanting to test check and to produce these materials for their own use. Notwithstanding that, we've actually also been developing with IDATI a mask, a graphene mask, which is used to actually produce defense against COVID-19. Everyone's talking about this, but we've actually got this happening. It's available in the marketplace, and we've already got interest in Taiwan and Korea. So this is the team. Well, there's only two, but we do have others. Me, I'm based in the UK. I've been involved in AIM-listed businesses and others. And I'm chairman of the standardization committee for graphene across China and the UK. And the CEO is Patrick Franz, who's been involved in many, many things for a long time, worked with me in Thailand and Asia, setting up the sites over there for former company Haydel. So I've rushed through that a little bit. That's really us. I'm going to stop the information you need, and a copy of this document is available afterwards. And also, if you're interested in what we're doing on the planarTECH seeding round, it's there for you on top of on this list. Over to you, Andrew.
Great, thanks very much indeed. Look, a considerable number of questions coming in. Firstly, you touched on it slightly there, but what about some of the application potential uses when it comes to diagnostics? I mean, you talked about masks, you touched briefly on COVID and coronavirus, but what about graphene when it comes to that space?
In terms of diagnostics, it's because it's very sensitive. A single layer sheet of graphene is 64 angstroms thin. If you put 3 million layers together, it's a millimeter thick, it's that thin. And the sensitivity relating to graphene, pure graphene, is absolutely dynamic, and if provided you get the right diagnostic tests, the right proteins and the right enzymes, you can actually make some good diagnostics. And it's already being used in screen printing biomedical sensors for diabetes testing. So from that perspective, yes, it's already out and about, and we are working on one in the COVID-19. I can't talk about it very much, but we're actually using some very clever people in Manchester University to help us make that happen.
What about, I know you and I have spoken in the past a number of times, and you say graphene's now approaching the tipping point, exactly. Why has it taken so long to reach this point, and sort of for people to just understand how valuable it is?
Well, actually, it's only 15 years young, really, if you think about it. It was first isolated in 2004. How long did carbon fiber take before it actually became used universally? 20, 25 years. So in this respect, it's very quick. Also, hype surrounded graphene to start with, and many people put it on a banner and said it's going to change the world instantaneously. Advanced materials doesn't do that. It takes a while to generate consistency, and that's actually now happening, and a range of applications, and nobody necessarily wants to be the first person into this to do it. However, nobody also wants to be the last. So there's an awful lot now that are jumping on the bandwagon. And if you think about Ford put an aerogel into their Ford Mustang P150 to deaden the noise, and actually got a thermal interface as well, and actually reduced the heat in the engine block, which made a more efficient engine work. And it took them 4 years to do that, which actually in the automotive sector is not that long. So there's many, many things in the tipping point. We're seeing, actually, believe it or not, graphene going into concrete now. At the moment, the world's worst polluter in the world is concrete manufacturing. 6% of all CO2 comes out of concrete. So There's a lot of activity happening in this now. I do keep talking about the tipping point, Andrew. You are absolutely correct. And we are now getting to the stage where everybody is talking about it. But more importantly than that, real life applications are happening almost daily.
What about scope to use graphene as far as telecoms and home broadband?
So that's an interesting dynamic. You could take this beyond all sorts of things. If you think about the fact that copper wire and wire is used extensively everywhere in aircraft, in cars, in wiring looms, in the house, wherever it might be, just think about the fact that you could end up, this is taking it a bit further, you could end up spraying or putting a coating of graphene down and it becoming the conduit for actually taking the electronics into your house, removing copper. That's a fair way away, but it does impact and it will impact on many, many things where precious metals are used. Take platinum, for example. I know, for instance, that that's actually being looked at to reduce the amount of catalytic platinum in catalytic converters as well. I'm losing my voice.
Interesting question. Can graphene be 3D printed?
On its own, I do know of a company that's trying to do that. It can be. It's technically massively challenging. Having added graphene into various other products, yes, it can be printed. Certainly in organic material like PLA, into other activities. I know you can print concrete with graphene in. And a variety of things. I don't think there's any opportunity not to do it. The only thing that graphene struggles with going into very easily is metal.
What about the longer term plans here for planarTECH? Are you looking to come to the public markets at all?
The CEDARS platform allows us to do that, or actually allows the investors to decide to get out on the secondary market themselves. At the moment, we have no plan to do that, but never say never. And having been in the public markets often, I can see the benefits. And there are also quite a lot of downsides as well. You have to tell the whole world what you're doing. Sometimes you don't want to do that from a strategic perspective. So there are issues relating to that. But the access to capital is quite stunning, provided you get it right.
Does planarTECH qualify for EIS relief?
Correct, it does.
And what about so just tell us more, Ray, what are your main markets here? Is Asia a particular focus for you?
I think the three drivers of everything in relating to advanced materials is broadly 40-20-20, 40% in the States, 20% EU, 40%+ in Asia. Yes, Asia is a big market. Yes, they're very innovative. Yes, they're moving quickly to put things together in the electronics market, adding thermal dynamics and a range of other things. However, what's interesting is the way that in the UK, we've suddenly developed the ability to make things very rapidly, which is something that has been happening in Asia for a long, long time. And I find it quite interesting that suddenly we can get ventilators made within 2 or 3 weeks. Whereas before, if you put it into the normal world, it would take months and months and months and maybe years. So there is a beginnings of self-sustainability and entrepreneurship in the EU. And I think that will continue, and that's a really good thing. But we shouldn't lose sight of the fact the world is a global thing, and graphene has many, many global applications. So I think it will dominate many markets, but in a way that's an additive to something, not necessarily a universal panacea on its own. It's always going to be an additive.
Well, tell us a bit more. For planarTECH, what's the sales cycle that you've seen? I mean, how tricky is it to secure some of these new customers?
So some of the customers, they've primarily been research institutions and academics and universities, and they all get their budgets. And they often think about making their spend and then suddenly decide that they've got to spend it before the end of their year. And suddenly it's very urgent. So it can, the count from having a wish list of saying I'm going to buy, suddenly saying, well, and then all of a sudden, yes, I'm going to do it, because that's actually months before my year end. And if I don't spend it, I'll lose it. So that the cycle can be unpredictable. However, what we're seeing is a range of businesses now that are actually, or I should say, universities coming on board saying, we're massively looking at next generation two-dimensional materials. I mentioned the TMDs and the molybdenum disulfides, which actually, as far as graphene is concerned, graphene is great. They've identified it. It works very well. And it's now all about the commercialization of graphene, which is what we're talking about here. But we've got a fantastic visibility onto the next generation materials that are coming out of the research institutions. And that puts us in a fantastically unique position. The sales cycle itself begins to happen. I think if you look at planarTECH's results, you'll see that they turned over about £1 million every year pretty consistently. Some of them were up and down a bit, but by and large, what I think is encouraging is that universities have repeat bought. The National University of Singapore has done that. The Cambridge University, the Manchester Universities, Stanford, Rice University, really high quality people buying kit from a small outfit based in the UK.
And Ray, we've got a question in here from Robin. He's asking, I mean, you did briefly mention a bit earlier, but as far as the competition, are there many others out there making the similar type of kit, these similar types of machines?
There is CVD based equipment core, but they tend to be in a bigger end of the market. There's a company called Einstrom, which is German, and what they've done is they've focused on, or trying to focus on, reel to reel process, which is not so straightforward. They are bigger than us, but we tend to have captured a niche. We haven't done badly for 5 years when we've taken the fact that we've actually got 65 plus systems in the marketplace. So yes, there are competition, but we don't see them doing the sort of systems that we do. And actually, one of our unique selling points is we've got a modular based system that can achieve what it wants to do for the customer, as opposed to we've always got this system, take it or leave it type of thing, you know? So the customers can come along and the universities can say, can I have an interlock? Can I have a different system? Can I have a twin tube? Can I do this, that, and the other? Can you make a hybrid system? And we can do that because we are niche and be able to move quickly. And they're prepared to pay a reasonable sum of money, which gives us a decent profit.
Great. Thanks. Very interesting. Lovely to hear from you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
And next up tonight, similar to Ray Gibbs, a man who needs no introduction, Sir Martin Sorrell from S4 Capital. He's here to talk us through the business, offering up his views on the current marketing and advertising landscape. I believe he's here. He's with us now. Sir Martin. He is with us. We can't quite hear him just yet. We might just need to activate his microphone. I think we may need to, we'll give it another couple of goes, a couple of seconds. Sir Martin, can you hear us? He can hear us. He can hear us well, I believe. According to my lip reading skills, I believe he can hear us. We may need to return to Sir Martin. We might have to move on to our next guest this evening. Well, I believe he is waiting in the wings from Tiziana Life Sciences tonight. We're joined by Gabriele Cerrone. I believe, hopefully, he's ready. I know he doesn't mind the odd surprise now and then. He might be taken a little bit aback by his early appearance with us tonight here at Proactive. Don't forget Ray Gibbs from planarTECH. All his previous videos, his conferences, his videos with us, they're available on the Proactive website. Visit us, proactiveinvestors.co.uk. But Gabriele Cerrone, he's with us tonight, I believe, from his home here in London. a lot of really interesting stuff happening with them. Of course, they've had a bit of news around what they're doing with coronavirus and COVID-19 and their latest drug. I think we can bring in Gabriele now. Gabriele, tell us a bit about the business, what you're up to at the moment. And Gabriele, I think we're struggling to hear from you as well. You might just need to activate your microphone if you can, Gabriele. If you can push the button on your computer next to your camera. He can see us. We're having a similar issue. We can see him. He can see us. But we can't hear from him either.
Hi, Gabriele. Can you turn your microphone on? There's an icon just next to the camera icon above the PowerPoint you have. Maybe try taking the headphones out. Okay. I think we will we'll have to go to Open Orphan for now. Do you think? And then
should we? We'll give Cahill's laptop a go. See if that's willing to play ball tonight.
Yeah, and then if you want to try and log back in to the webinar room, Gabriele, we can get you on after Open Orphan. Okay.
Here we go. Let's see if we can bring Cahill in at this point. See if the technology is working for Cahill tonight. Cahill, good evening.
Scott, how are you? Can you hear me okay?
What a relief. Actually, the audio works. The system's working tonight. Cahill, look, good to see you. It's been a little while. We've had a bit of radio silence from you the last couple of weeks. So, look, we'll give Thomas a couple of moments just to bring up your presentation. Loads of exciting stuff happening with you. How have you been?
Yep, it's got pretty good, pretty busy, as you know, the last couple of months pretty busy, and even busier the last couple of weeks. How have you been?
Very well indeed. Look, Cahill, what have you been busy doing? Of course, you've got your quarantine facility in Europe. What's going on there?
Yeah, look, if you'd pick, we're all looking for a COVID-19 story, and I think the luckiest decision in my life was putting half of my life savings into Open Orphan and then rolling the dice, acquiring an unloved asset called HVivo. We acquired it in January when nobody wanted to know what a company that tested vaccines and antivirals were. If you'd asked me 6 months ago what such a company was, I didn't know about it. But suddenly I think most people in the UK, most people tonight know as much as I do that a company that tests vaccines and antivirals is a pretty interesting business to have.
Well, absolutely. I mean, in hindsight, this merger, this acquisition here with HVivo, a fantastic team, that was quite a shrewd move for you.
Well, I wouldn't say shrewd, lucky. Sometimes you get lucky. And I'm a big fan. I would class myself as a child of Margaret Thatcher. I bought my first share in 1981. I bought SIDS, BTs, followed them all. And to quote Margaret, she used to say, the harder you work, the luckier you get. So I think it was just a bit of hard work and we got lucky. We stumbled on something very interesting, very exciting, and it's great in the current environment. I'm an Irish guy, but I have a proud British passport and an Irish passport because I was born in Londonderry, which had given me both options. But it's great to have a company that we can say, this is a great British company. We are the world leaders. HVivo in East London is the world leaders in the testing of vaccines and antivirals. So it's a nice company I've picked up.
Well, indeed. Look, Cahill, we've got your presentation ready. So people have tuned in to hear from you, not me. So I'll hand it over to you. And let us know what's going on.
Okay, let me bring through. Here we are, folks. Listen, thank you very much for taking the time to see the different presentations from us all tonight. What I intend to do, I'll talk generally around this slide, given my Irish accent and my propensity for speaking too fast. What I'll do, I'll talk about this slide, and then I'll actually read most of the following slides. This deck, I gather, is available on the Proactive website. It's also our standard investor presentation, so it's a little long, but it's available in the Pro on our Open Orphan website under Investors. So if you go to the Investors section, you can download a copy of it as well afterwards. But as I said, Proactive have a copy. So this is the first deck, straight, and everything we're showing tonight is our normal investor presentation from our website, so there's nothing sensitive. Basically, Open Orphan, we're a unique European niche CRO, which I say is now, as of the last 2 months, we're the world leader in the running of trials to test vaccines and antivirals. That's a pretty exciting space to be in. And what is it? How do we get to that stage? I'm just setting my timer, folks, just to keep an eye on the time. I forgot to set my timer. So what are we? Open Orphan. Look, we only established the company, IPO'd it June last year. We acquired the company on the left, top right, Van Life Science, has an office in Breda, which is outside Amsterdam, and Paris. It's an early stage drug development. It does the early preclinical. But funny enough, despite it not being huge in vaccines, it did a lot of work last year and again earlier this year for one of the first Ebola vaccines, which has now become back in the frame. It's done quite a lot of other vaccine work over the years, but predominantly then would have been a preclinical that does, you help the drug companies get ready to get into the clinic. What else have we in Open Orphan? We've got Open Orphan genomic health data. That was something we had put together this last 2 years. We funded it ourselves. It's collecting data in a low-cost way, genomic data. But guess what? Coming to our hVIVO acquisition, Open Orphan genomic data now, hVIVO has 20 years of clinical test infectious disease data. Within that, quite a lot of genomic data. So overnight, with the acquisition we did in January, our Open Orphan health data platform now is going to have a lot of data. We always said it would take a year, year and a half, 2 years to get that data. Now we've got it in 3 months. So that's a nice place to be. Going forward, being frank and honest, I think you'll hear less of the orphan and more of the vaccines and infectious data. And over the months and weeks ahead and years, if we're around that long, if we haven't got bought out, we'll be really focusing on an infectious disease company. Orphan drugs are still a very important part of our plans, but infectious diseases, i.e. things we catch infections with. Infectious diseases, as we all know, were not popular. We acquired hVIVO because nobody wanted it 3 months ago. But infectious diseases are things you catch, i.e. mainly viruses. So taking that, what did we get with hVIVO? First of all, top left-hand corner, it's a world leader in the testing of vaccines. Up to 3 months ago, that was a tiny niche. It was easy being the world leader in the market. It was only 50 to 80 million a year. hVIVO annually did about 20 million in revenue. That's, we did close to that last year. So they had about a quarter of the market themselves. However, I think we all know there's going to be an awful lot more vaccines in development, an awful lot more antivirals, not alone when our COVID issue passes through. There's going to be a resurgence at looking at flu, a resurgence at looking at RSV, and all these other viral infections that the government's kind of ignored and vaccine companies didn't focus on. What was in with hVIVO? We got the world's only 24-bed full quarantine clinic in Whitechapel, East London. We got an on-site virology laboratory. But really importantly, and we were only putting this, our lottery ticket, we own 48% of ImmuTech. ImmuTech is basically a joint venture company. It's jointly owned with ourselves and the Seek Group. A lot of money went into it, but it has developed and it's getting ready for phase three, universal flu vaccine. That is today phenomenally interesting. 6 months ago, the world wasn't that excited about having a universal flu vaccine. It's based on T cells, which is peptide based, and it's very easy taking a universal flu vaccine and swap out the flu peptides and swap in coronavirus peptides. And guess what you get? You have a universal coronavirus vaccine. Now, that's some time away. The focus is on the flu at the moment. And also within ImmuTech, it also has a phase one completed universal mosquito saliva vaccine that will be effective against malaria, dengue fever, zika, anything one catches from mosquitoes. It's using that T-cell peptide-based technology again. So that I've said earlier this year is our lottery ticket. That lottery ticket is getting more interesting literally by the day. We are not, and I'm reassuring all our loyal shareholders, we're not going to waste shareholder money and putting any more money into developing those drugs. We all know the drug business, high risk, high reward. We want to focus on the high reward, high value, high profitable services arm, but that we are focused, and there's a lot of efforts to farm out to a large pharma company that phase three trial, which will involve upfront payments, license payments, etc. And that lottery ticket could get much more interesting in rapidly as we move forward. Also within hVIVO, this is a new piece you haven't seen in our deck before, a repurposed influenza immune modulator. Big mouthful for somebody like me with an Irish accent, but that basically is, again, it's an influenza product of which we actually own. So for a little company, we're listed less than 10 months. I think looking there, you have any one of that combination could transform the company, but instead we actually have a range of assets. All of them fit nicely together. All of them are in the space. And our plan now is, how do we generate the best return on investment? Let me take you to the next slides. And as said, I'm going to really talk you through them because conscious the Irish accent, my ability to speak in too fast, and a lot of ground to cover. Let's talk you through the slides. Open Orphan, I think people know this. Just very briefly, we've got 549 million shares in issue, market cap 35, 40 million. It varies, as you know, it pops up and down 10, 20%. That was the end of March. End of March, we still had 4 million in the bank, which was a rather nice place to be. Small bit of debt, that's a soft loan. Most of that is from myself and friends and family that we turned the company around over a year ago. It won't cause us any problems. It completed its IPO June last year, taking over one struggling listed company, Venn Life Science. We raised 4.5 million at 5.6p. And then in January, we acquired the ACE, hVIVO, for 13 million. In that 13 million, it was all equity, and the company came with 2 million in cash as well. We raised 5.3 million in fresh equity at 6.1. We made clear we're going to consolidate them, take out a lot of the overheads. That's virtually done and then amalgamate them, strip them down, and become a very profitable, long-term, sustainable services company. And we said basically in the infectious diseases, in testing vaccines and antivirals. And then the other products we have, such as the vaccines, they'll be funded off balance sheet by Big Pharma. We have an office in London. We're going to be very London-centric going forward. We did have an Irish office. It's gone. We did have a German office. It's gone. We had a second Dutch office. It's gone. We're now basically mainly London. It's very small and getting smaller. Paris office, a Breda office in the Netherlands, and that's it. Shareholders, myself and my co-founders, we've over 20%. We put our money where our mouth is, and we're locked up for 3 years from June last year. Invesco, 9.5%. Link, former Widfor stake, 7.3%. And we have a range of other small stakes from institutions. They're below 3%, so they're not disclosable. And then we have a very loyal bunch of retail investors who we would like to try and give everybody a very good return in the months ahead. I'm not going to bore the management team. I think we've talked enough about that. Other than I'm making it very clear, my role as executive chairman is a kind of funny one. It's kind of a very hands-on quasi-CEO role. I'm not having half my net worth tied up in the company unless I'm very hands-on. We have a good team. Trevor Phillips, we inherited from hVIVO. Leo, we took across from Open Orphan. He's old-school financial controller. Our chief financial officer, he's really driving the costs through. And Tim Sharpington, chief operating officer. We have a lot of knowledge of Tim. He worked with our other co-founder, Brenton Buckley, and Icon. And Tim has been given the job of basically pulling all the bits together and driving it. Non-execs, keeping it slim, Michael Mead, Mark Warren, and my fellow Open Orphan Show co-founder, Brenton Buckley. Management team is going to be kept small and getting smaller as we speak. Board small. We don't intend building any big monolithic. This is a turn it around, fix it style company. Moving on to our next slide. How do these businesses fit together? Complementary services business. Most people would have said 6 months ago, Cathal, you bought Venn Life Science. How do you tack that onto something? Well, basically, they fit together like a glove. And let me talk to you. What's within hVIVO? It's a London-based. It's a world leader in the testing, the efficacy, i.e. do the work of vaccines, antiviral, and other respiratory disease agents through the provision of our own proprietary, in-house developed, grown versions of disease-specific viruses. long mouthful, but they're known as challenge studies. That's basically, we develop our own virus and we use them to test a vaccine. They're run from a 24-bed quarantine clinic in London with his on-site virology laboratory. Go to FluCamp, www.flucamp.com, to see how we manage our volunteers. We pay £3,500 per volunteer for them to come for 10 days to be part of a trial. It is a world-leading portfolio of 8 controlled human infection and viral studies. That's our IP. A lot of money. To replace that would be 25, 30 million, those 8 challenge study models. Challenge study models, that's our own 8 viruses of which we own in-house. Nobody else can use them or copy them. The really interesting part, we have developed the world's first coronavirus challenge study model. 6 weeks ago, we announced that, and that's coming together rather nicely. We're also looking in conjunction, the world's first COVID-19 challenge study model in conjunction with that. We have over 20 years of running clinical trials and vaccines, and many of, and this is really important, if you read the following names, and anybody following the vaccine race, we call it, the following names of existing customers of hVIVO, and there's many more: Merck, Genentech, GSK, Gilead, Vertex, Janssen, Elanta, Centrio, and look at that one, DARPA. That's the American Defense Research Organization, a long-term customer of hVIVO. How does that fit together with Venn? Venn is the early stage consultancy. We do the work pre the challenge study. And again, look at some of those customers we have there, going back 30 years. Boehringer Ingelheim, second biggest German company. Ipsen, one of the biggest French companies. Janssen, Huge, Servier, Galapagos, Prometeor. A range of orphan drug, but more or less large European companies. How did a little company like Open Orphan, 2 years old, acquire these? Basically, Venn acquired a 30-year-old company some years ago in Paris called Cardinal, and it had acquired these. It also acquired a Dutch company called Kinesis. For us to get a fraction of these would take decades. So this is the beauty of acquiring long-established pharma services companies. The customer base can be very, very sticky and they stay with us. So hopefully you see these two businesses, hVIVO and Venn, fit together like an absolute glove. And I'll talk that through, I think, on one of our first big deals we announced last month, where we had the preclinical coming from Venn, the data services, the data, and hVIVO doing the actual challenge study. I think it's appropriate in their slide now to talk briefly for a couple of minutes, what is a challenge study model? And really, why are we so excited to having the world's first coronavirus challenge study model? Basically, in March, we announced we initiated the development of a coronavirus challenge study model. Like our other models, the model will involve recruiting healthy volunteers, inoculating them, that means giving them the virus, in quarantine, monitoring the disease and return them to health after we have tested the vaccine. This will aid in the fast tracks in the testing of antiviral and vaccines against the coronavirus family. As insufficient data is available at present to be able to use the direct COVID-19, but the exciting part there is that we're actively looking at using the attenuated, that's a milder version of COVID-19, because as we know, there is about a dozen vaccines around the world in the great vaccine race. And in my earlier slides, he knows a number of our existing customers are well ahead of the game, and many of them in discussions with us. So we're going to provide them a platform to rapidly test those vaccines. The graph on the right, 10 days, the patients or the volunteers get a version of the vaccine 4 to 2 weeks before they come into our clinic, because the vaccine gives them protection. We bring them in day one, we settle them in, and we give them a version of the disease that we have, that's basically our challenge study model. They do get a little sick, i.e. the bed at the top of the graph. Usually it's nothing more than a mild version of the cold, flu, sniffiness. And then we monitor them. Half of them will have been given a placebo, half of them would have been given the proper vaccine. At the end of the 10 days, we can see exactly did that vaccine work or did that vaccine not. With 24 at a time, we will see that the 12 with the vaccine avoid getting the disease and the 12 with the placebo did. So that's simply what a challenge study model is. We've said the jewel in the crown, hVIVO, is a very extensive asset portfolio. Just look at that. We've got a 24-bed. It's almost like a private hospital in East London. It's part of Queen Mary's Hospital Innovation Centre. A huge sum of money was poured in there. And it sat idle. Last year, people are wondering, where are we now at the moment? Most years, 25-30% is the most occupancy. So hence the reason to the 20 million in revenue there. Fill that up to capacity of where we're aiming for this year. 85% would be capacity. We can do 40 million in revenues easy with our eyes closed there. They have on-site a virology laboratory. And again, testing, we're actively in discussion and offering the government, the UK government that is, to rapidly with robotic testing in there to help them test coronavirus people within the UK. So we can make multiple uses of the laboratory. I think I've talked through at the bottom there, what is the human challenge model? It's an area of science that's getting very interesting because it allows vaccine companies to really speed up, does the vaccine work or not? Where we are, vaccines and the portfolio we have. We are a services company, but I keep saying by acquiring hVIVO, we got this 48% stake that has two really interesting products. Immutex, what's in it? Basically, it has a phase 3 ready vaccine and has a phase 1 completed mosquito. That is a nice asset of assets to have in the current environment. We say there's our lottery ticket, and actually that lottery ticket is getting much more interesting today. I've always advocated people, don't, it's not a guarantee, but I think a year ago, and even 6 months ago, the hVIVO management team tried to elicit interest in a universal flu vaccine. And a lot of the big pharma companies in the world say, oh yeah, Jan, have you not got something in oncology? Have you not got something that fights cancer? Have you not got something else? And then suddenly a lot of those parties back say, oh, remember that flu vaccine you had? Maybe we should look at that. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll have news on that in the coming weeks and months ahead. We've also said the other product we have, the open orphan data, that's collecting genetic data. We've always said it would take us a year to a year and a half to get sufficient data into that platform on a low cost basis. Now we have all the data we need with hVIVO. There's 20 years of infectious disease, most of it genomic, i.e. we've got blood samples, etc. So we're going to have our platform pretty well populated over the next couple of months and the basis that we can start selling access to that data. Repurposed immune modeler, influenza is again a product. It's phase 2 ready. Again, another area, and it actually has potential for COVID-19. The reason that is, the biggest problem with a lot of the COVID patients is they get this cytokine storm. So this is a product that would actually modulate that. So again, it's an interesting asset. It's almost literally we found in the basement. Say, wow, look at this. When you acquire these companies, some of the time the companies don't even know what they have in their basements. And this was literally one that came free with the hVIVO acquisition. I think I've spoken off the genomic. Yes?
If you don't mind me interrupting, just a minute or two left before we get to some of these questions. We're getting inundated with questions for you, Cathal.
Okay.
So just a minute or two, if you can.
Minute or two coming up. High value, we'll whiz through, I showed this before. Putting the two companies together, we're going for much higher value contracts. And you've seen that last month. The first contract we announced was 3.2 million with a secondary contract of 7. So that contract will be worth 10 million to us this year. That's a single contract that hVIVO got. Open Orphan, spoken of in that. Let me get the thing where people want to know about it. Where are we with the pipeline? This has been on our website, 81 million of a pipeline. Client A, that's the one we announced last month, 2.4 million. Turns out, guess what? It turned out a 3.2 million contract. The main RSV challenge is 7.2. That is part of that first contract, and it's also looking pretty darn good as we speak. So that's attitude together, that's a 10 million already before we get going. All we can say is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, they're a work in progress. We will have news getting these large contracts signed. We're very optimistic. They're at lawyer stage, most of them. With the lockdown, lots of lawyers working from home, things are taking a little longer, but I'll say watch this space. In the coming weeks, we'll have more news flow in that pipeline. Last slide, hopefully, Scott, we're on time then. It's just basically, look, put the two companies together. We're generating longer-term revenue synergies. We've taken out most overheads, and I think we've a very exciting 6 or 12 months ahead. So, Scott, I think back to you for questions.
Cathal. Look, very good. We've got plenty to get through. We'll do as many as we can. Look, firstly, I suppose the obvious in the room, the lockdown, the restrictions at the moment, Cathal. How's that affecting business and these trials?
We're very lucky across the Venn group. Everybody works from home, and traditionally the Paris office and the Amsterdam office actually worked at least one day a week from home. So virtually no effect there. So that's pretty good. Their contracts would have been more modest, 300,000-500,000 contracts. There are a lot of them are preclinical, so they're steady she goes. The contracts that some of them you'll see in the market there's issues with are ones where you're bringing patients into hospitals. That brings the cost to hVIVO. hVIVO at the moment has probably one of the best pipeline of inquiries it ever had in 20 years. People that we never spoke to before are saying, can we get into your clinic? Yes, the lockdown at the moment has our clinic locked down, but at a moment's notice, we can go back to the UK government and say, we want to open it. We want to cooperate with the government for another couple of weeks, but take it as read, we are planning on reopening the clinic from early to mid-May. We're in a lucky position. We've got a lot of volunteers. When we announced we're doing the coronavirus challenge study, flu camp normally gets 30 to 40 volunteers signed up per week. And we, in a 5-week period, we signed up 10,000 volunteers per week. So as soon as we're getting ready to go, within 3-4 weeks, we can have the clinic up and running and hopefully jam solid till Christmas. So yes, anybody tells you at the moment that lockdown has absolutely no effect, we'd be telling a lie. Mild effect, nothing we can't deal with, but quid pro quo, best pipeline ever in the history of the company.
Are you still talking to Chinese pharmaceutical companies, Cathal, around the financing for the coronavirus challenge study?
Absolutely. And there's very active, very continual interest from China. There is, it's quite interesting to watch, it's almost the great race is on again. That brings us back to history. But there is a great race. If you look carefully on our client, past client list, the names of most of the great races are there for the vaccine. But China is coming up fast. It has three companies that are putting vaccine, one in particular in, vaccinated 500 people last week. They do need a challenge study. So there's a lot of dialogue. China has a lot of respiratory, not just coronavirus, corona is a respiratory, with smog and one of the highest percentage of smokers in the world. There's a huge interest in China getting access to vaccines and, more importantly, getting access to our technology. China would love to clone what we have in London. We've told them all, yeah, please clone us, but pay for the pleasure, i.e. take us out or pay us a very large sum of money. So, yeah, this is where hVIVO is positioned in East London. It's a great crossroads. We do have DARPA, which is the dark end of the American government, as a major long-term customer. They have no issue. We've dealt with lots of companies across the world, and now we've open arms to dealing with our Chinese colleagues and friends.
What about, Cathal, as far as these discussions and negotiations with regulators for a pathway for approval for the flu V? Where are you at with that?
Yeah, look, good question. And in a crisis at the moment, lots of pathways get shortened. And I'm sure everybody listening, when is the vaccine coming? When's the vaccine coming? The issue with the vaccine, and let me come to all of them, is that people worry about taking shortcuts, because with a vaccine, you're putting a version of a virus into the human body. It's a live, living organism. So you've got to be careful what happens it. So particularly with our universal flu vaccine, up to 6 months ago, 12 months ago, there was a great wariness. Oh, well, this is a novel. It's a T-cell based. How are you going to go there? At the moment, governments around the world are looking, wow, there has to be a quicker, more efficient way of getting these products. So there's a discussion with the FDA at the moment in regards to universal flu. And as soon as that completes, it'll be another month or two, we'll be making an announcement. And then that positions flu V for the next stage of its journey. But that discussion has got easier by the day.
It wouldn't hurt. I know you and I have spoken about it, and indeed you've touched on it tonight, but just for those perhaps tuning in for the first time as to what Open Orphan's about, what's the actual business model? Are you looking to provide a service, or are you taking stakes in drug companies, or what's the actual plan?
I'll be very crude. Our business model is very simple: to make as much money as possible for our shareholders. And I'm personally being one of the largest shareholders, so I look I've been around. I'm 55. I said I bought my first share in November 1981. I'm one of Margaret Thatcher's children. So I think shareholders, we've made clear on AIM, are sick of companies going nowhere. So I think our business model is to make as much money as possible in the shortest period of time for all our shareholders. And that's the model. But all joking aside, it's a good mantra to have. And how are we doing that? We're focused on profitable services. My other company that I set up and formed that is going really well is Amrit Pharma PLC. It's only 4.5 years old. It did 150 million in pharma revenues last year. It was a high risk, high reward company, a typical pharma company. It could have went bust on us very easy. Second time out, which is for this type of company, went services. It's not going to, the company's not going to go skyrocket or it's not going to collapse on us. Pharma services are high margin, high profits, and reasonable rewards. We do have these products, the Flu V, we've got them for free. The mosquito vaccine, we got it for free. And the immune modulator, we got it for free. We've attributed no value to them. We call them like lottery tickets. But in the current environment, as I said at the start, I think acquiring HVivo was probably one of the luckiest things. It wasn't the shrewdest. It was basically luck. But it was actually, we're really excited to have acquired it.
Given this push at the moment towards treatments and vaccines for COVID-19, coronavirus, and all the efforts that are being put into this, is there a risk that you're going to be overtaken by some others with bigger pockets, perhaps?
Sorry, rephrase the question again?
The push here that we're seeing towards finding a vaccine and treatments for COVID-19, you know, other labs that are doing similar work, is there a chance that your efforts, they're going to be overtaken as far as developing some treatment or some vaccine towards the treatment?
Scott, lovely. That sounds like a planted question I'd put myself, all right? No, the one benefit, look, we're in a terribly small niche, the challenge study provision niche. I said we're a great East London company. We're the world leaders in that because the nearest competitor has a 7-bed clinic in Belgium and has basically struggles to get patients. And the only competitor is West Coast Clinical Trials in San Diego and has no beds. So we're in a lucky position to run it. You have to have that quarantine clinic. We're the world leaders in it. So there's nobody going to bypass us. We have the models, i.e. that's the homegrown viruses we own and control. Our big issue is trying to best navigate the pathway in the next 2, 3, 4, 5 months and make sure that we're part of the successful evolution of the next coronavirus vaccines.
You've said it a couple of times. I mean, even tonight, the last times we've caught up in the studio, as far as your exit strategy, you're keen to realize some value for shareholders and move things forward. Have you had to recalibrate or readjust your expectations as far as profitability and any timelines given the lockdown and the disruptions at the moment?
No. Look, we've made very clear this company must be profitable. We bought two loss-making companies. They must be profitable. No changes there. The lockdown, basically, look, being frank, it came at a very convenient, wouldn't say inconvenient time. The lockdown, the only part that's affecting us is running the clinic. But the clinic at the moment, we're between trials. As I said, the clinic last year was only 25% occupancy. We're going to target a much higher occupancy this year. So no, the lockdown doesn't have that much effect. All the other HVivo staff are working very successfully from home. And say our VEN staff in Paris and Amsterdam have a long tradition of working from home, going back many, many years. So no, we're quite lucky. But we tell a lie. Anybody who says the lockdowns have a no effect, that's an absolute lie. It has effect. People have to work harder, longer. It's anybody with children at home, it's trickier. But no, I think it's look, we're in as good a place as we could have imagined. I started off saying everybody's looking for a COVID-19 story. Our front page of the deck, we've got about half a dozen of them. As you said, I've gone quiet the last 3 weeks. That is basically, I think, the world, including myself, anybody who has shares, is having a hard time. So we didn't want to be shouting and jumping and making loads of noise. We want to now, over the coming weeks, deliver results, be in the right place. And we've always said, look, this was rapidly put one or two, we put the two of them together, small AIM listed companies, stop the messing around with the losses, take out the bulk of the management team, keep them narrow, and being honest with you, present the company in a neat position to be bought out by a much bigger player. Our ultimate aim would, if we can make sure and hold the course and genuinely not mess up, this is a fabulous asset for a larger company to acquire later this year or early next year at the latest.
Cathal, look, very much indeed. Thanks very much for your time tonight. We've got a lot of other questions which we didn't get around to putting to you. If you could, as well as Ray from planarTECH, if you could be so kind as to not go too far, stand by your laptops. We're going to have another go at Sir Martin and Gabriele to see if we can connect and chat with them. I know we've had an incredible number of people tuning in tonight, almost 700 people as we sit at the moment tuning in, listening, taking all this in. So look, incredible numbers. Thanks very much indeed for everybody watching. We're going to have another go at Sir Martin, see if we can connect. I can see him there. Can't hear too much as far as audio at the moment. But Sir Martin, can you hear us?
Well, I haven't spoken yet. Can you hear me now?
Well, that'll be why I couldn't hear you. Look, Sir Martin, thanks very much indeed. And we can still hear you. Here we go. Look, if you can, I spoke to you earlier this week as far as what's going on with SFOR and your business model, your strategy. But look, I'll hand it over to you and touch wood while the internet connection holds up. Tell us a bit about what's going on and what your plans are.
Well, we have four core principles, Andrew. The first is we're purely digital because that's where the growth is. Pre-COVID, the digital industry was about $250 billion. Of advertising revenues from media last year out of a total worldwide of 550 to 600 billion, so about 45%, growing at about 20%, with the industry as a whole growing at about 4 or 5%. So traditional media were down, and we'll come back to that in a second. The second principle is that we're based purely in digital around three areas, what we call the Holy Trinity of first-party data driving the production or creation of digital advertising content and programmatic. The third principle is how we go to market as faster, better, cheaper. Faster means agility, the key attribute pre-COVID and post-COVID, even more of the key attribute for any company, particularly those who are moving from analog to digital. Better means an understanding of the digital ecosystem, which 16 companies or so, Google, Facebook, Amazon, Tencent, Alibaba, TikTok, Apple, Microsoft, Adobe, Oracle, Salesforce, IBM, SAP, ByteDance I've mentioned, which is the parent of TikTok, Baidu, Chinese search, and then probably Twitter and Snap. Those would be the 16, you could add Samsung, you could add Pinterest, there are others, but those are the companies that we really have to understand in the ecosystem. And cheaper means not ZBB anymore, not zero-based budgeting anymore, but that's somewhat discredited, but certainly accent on efficiency, which coming out of COVID will be as important, maybe even more important. And the last fundamental principle is we're a unitary one P&L company. Not like the holding company model, which I was involved with for 33 years or so at WPP, not a fragmented sort of vertical model based on earnouts in terms of growth by acquisition, the inorganic growth, but a unitary company where people are really buying into the principles that we're talking about here and want to build a new era, new age model. So that's the background. And just to show you what's been happening in the industry, this is media spend, that 500, 550, 600 billion of spend and where the growth sector is. And you can see that digital has grown significantly faster than any of the traditional media. Print obviously has declined quite significantly. TV has held its own, but it's clearly coming under pressure, not just from digital, and in COVID we'll see that acceleration, but also from streaming, from Netflix, obviously, Disney Plus, Hulu, Roku, Peacock, and others. Radio continues to be a consistent performer, boosted a bit by digital radio, cinema small, but we're post-COVID, we have to see what happens there. And of course, outdoor is taking a big hit from COVID too. But digital remains the big driver. And here we've just loaded a few charts to show you how online platforms have grown over the years, how programmatic buying, a key part of our Holy Trinity, has grown, how paid search has grown, and of course, how e-commerce, which has literally exploded in the course of the COVID epidemic and with people being locked down in mandatory lockdowns. S4 Capital and its two constituent parts, Media Monks, our content practice, and Mighty Hive, our programmatic practice, are really the service layer for the tech companies, and you see many of them. Many of these are companies that we distribute, or we their media inventory, and they're also clients of ours. We're running pro rata now revenues of around $400 million, so about £350 million going into 2020. And we're dominated by tech. Tech is about a half of our business, with clients such as Google and a major telecoms client, which we can't mention in a public meeting because we have an NDA, but you can guess who it is, Facebook, Alibaba, Tencent, and others. The tech clients that we work with, often the press and analysts write that Google and Facebook are disintermediating agencies. We don't think that at all. We think they are, if they were frenemies a few years ago, they're much friendlier frenemies today, and they're partners with us, or we're junior partners to them, helping them distribute. Those 16 companies I mentioned, we're helping them distribute their technology, their platforms, their hardware, their software around the world. So we're really the service layer complementary to those technological companies. The other half of our business is focused, and I'll come on to that, in FMCG, in pharma and retail. I'll come back to that in a second. Our model, as I said, is faster, better, cheaper, or more elegantly put, as speed, quality, value. And it's a very agile, flexible model, which post-COVID will be even more relevant. And you can see that we have three sort of different ways of approaching clients. We have a managed service agency offering, outsourced really, an embedded model, which is a mixture of outsourcing and working client premises. For example, of our 2,500 people, about 550-600 are in Amsterdam, and the same number, 550-600 are in California. About almost 100 of those sit in Mountain View, as well as Los Angeles and San Francisco. And the Mountain View 100 really, they're not actually on the Google campus, but they're just across the freeway for security reasons. They can't be on the campus, but across the freeway servicing the client. So we have three basic models: the fully outsourced model, a hybrid embedded model, and the in-housing model. And then we have the two practices that I mentioned. We call them practices because we want to think of ourselves really as a consulting company rather than an agency network. And you can see some of the quotes there that refer to our success. And I mentioned clients. Half of our business, as I said, is in tech. Relatively buttressed during the course of COVID, we've seen the tech clients maintain their spending. I think there is some evidence they will be switching spend from half one to half two, particularly given the pressures that the platforms have with the pressure on small business, SMBs. People forget that Google, Facebook, Amazon, Tencent, Alibaba, and indeed TikTok, a large proportion of their revenues come from SMBs, which are the segment of the economy that is most under pressure. So I think you'll see that in the numbers coming up, the quarterly numbers, Q1 and into Q2 at the major platforms. But once we're through the impact of COVID, as I think we will be, as we get into Q4 of this year, Q3, I think, will be a little bit better from, obviously, relatively better from a very tough Q2, which I've described elsewhere as a bloodbath. Our tech clients, however, have maintained their spending. On the other side of the equation, you can see here mentioned P&G, Nestle, L'Oreal, Mondelez, Coca-Cola. All these companies are companies that we're working with in the FMCG era. Pharma has been a bit more protected. Bayer, Merck, and another major pharmaceutical company where we have an NDA, but one of the major pharmaceutical companies that we've been placed on the roster of. And retail, Walgreens Boots, Best Buy, we're working for all these companies. Probably, maybe the exception of pharma, have trimmed their budgets, cut their budgets as we have progressed through COVID. But they've switched money from traditional to digital. I mean, there's strong evidence they're finding the cost per thousand and performance of digital, even in a COVID world, to be relatively more attractive. So a strong client list. And as I said, technology is our main client segment. And you can see here the FANG, so Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and then Google. The FANG spending on worldwide on advertising has grown considerably. In fact, Amazon was reported by Ad Age recently as having become the biggest spender of the world, surpassing even Procter & Gamble. So a strong network there. Now, our momentum has been very strong. Our traditional strategy is around what we call land and expand, which means that we win a project, we win a program, demonstrate what we can do, and then build. So our relationship with Google, which is our biggest relationship, around about a quarter of our revenues in total, our relationship with Google has been built over the years organically and by merger, as we call it, because you know, all our businesses really are buying into the philosophy that we have. We're not acquiring businesses on earnouts. As I said, it creates far too much of a fragmented organization. But our land and expand strategy, you can see the group of clients at the top there spanning not just tech, but consumer packaged goods, fast-moving consumer goods in pharma, in retail, hospitality, and other areas. Our merger growth around Media Monks and Mighty Hive has also driven growth. And you can see their clients mentioned like HP and AB InBev and Akzo Nobel as well. And then the Holy Trinity growth, that's an emphasis on data, on programmatic and on content, has driven our growth as well. So Sprint and Bayer and Ace and Google and L'Oreal and AB InBev are examples of clients that we've developed through that holy trinity of purely digital capabilities. We from a standing start some 18, 21 months ago, from zero basically, from a shell company, with the merger with Media Monks in July of 2018, with the merger with Mighty Hive at the end of 2018, actually on Christmas Eve of that year. In 2019, we added six content companies to Media Monks, to our content practice, and three programmatic and data and analytics companies to Mighty Hive, to our programmatic practice. So we now have 2,500 people in 30 countries. The balance of our business is about 70% in North and South America, about 20% in Western Europe, and 10% in Asia Pacific. I'd like to get the balance to 40-20-40, because I believe that the future is very much going to be dominated by the Americas, that's North and South. EMEA and the Middle East will also be important. But Middle East and Africa will probably be the higher growth rates. And then, of course, Asia Pacific, particularly China and India. China already the second largest economy in the world, but will at some point in time surpass the United States, not on a comparative per capita basis. That's going to take a long, long time, but on an absolute basis. Numbers now, US is about 22 trillion out of a world of 75 trillion. China is around 12, I think, currently. So, but catching up and growth rate, despite COVID, probably will be pretty fast. But those two countries probably will dominate. India, of course, over time will become more important, although COVID may take a toll. A number of Indian clients we've spoken to are concerned about that. Geographically, from a country point of view, we don't have to be in more than 100 countries like we were at WPP. We only probably need to be in one other major country, and that's Germany, which we're shortly about to do something with. And we're making another couple of merger deals in data and analytics. But all three of those are small in the context of our company, because going into COVID, we're obviously very concerned about liquidity and balance sheets and making sure the balance sheet remains strong. We have net cash, zero debt, we're unlevered, and we have taken down our revolvers to protect ourselves as we go through Q2 and Q3 and Q4, and we feel good about that, and we don't want to prejudice that by overextending ourselves. So anything we do on the inorganic front will be modest, but will be important strategically, either geographically or by function. Data and analytics, by the way, with the nixing of third-party cookies by Google and Apple's move on its phones to nix third-party cookies, data and analytics has become a very, very important and dynamic area, even in the recession that we find ourselves in around COVID. Now, just giving you a timeline here in this slide of the mergers that we've done. As I said, the core was MediaMonks in 2018, the middle of 2018, Mighty Hive at the end. And then we added 6 content and 3 programmatic and data and analytics companies, building a strong cadre of entrepreneurs. These are people who believe very much in our mission of building a new era, new age, new media company. This is the new model, purely digital. I mean, some people wonder at how we managed to work from home in such a short period of time. Working from home comes naturally to our digital. They're not even digital first. These are digital natives people. Most of these people come from tech companies. They come from Google. They come from Yahoo. They come from Salesforce. They don't come from agencies. They come from production companies, highly creative, smaller production companies, which are much more flexible and much more agile in terms of use of technology. And they all believe in our ability to disrupt and disintermediate the traditional industry. An integration around those 9 mergers is critical. So around our content practice, around our programmatic practice, we've started to unify our operations through technology such as you see mentioned here, G Suite and Slack and Salesforce, etc. And commercially through, we've done it with companies such as the clients mentioned here. And of course, around our brands, around Mighty Hive in programmatic and data and MediaMonks around content. And we started to integrate our offices physically in places like Stockholm and Singapore and Amsterdam, San Francisco, and other locations. And one of the advantages we see of COVID, our second biggest investment that we make out of our revenues, about 60% are invested in people, our most important asset, our 2,500 people. Our second biggest investment is in property, around 6, 7, 8, 9%. So $400 million, you're talking about $250 million in people, investing in people, and probably around $25 million or a little bit more, $30 million in property. One of the things we're seeing in COVID already is this home working has had a dramatic impact on our people, and they're questioning whether we really want to invest that heavily in office property and whether we'd be better off being much more flexible in the way we work. I've just summarized here what our unaudited figures that were issued for the year. I think the figures that I would just draw your attention to is the second column from the right, which is the unaudited pro formas. And you can see there the 270 million of revenue, sterling of revenue. and the 42 million of adjusted operating profits, effectively EBITDA. We're going into 2020 running at a run rate really of about 400 million of revenue, dollars of revenue. That's net revenue, not gross revenue, net revenue, gross profit, and EBITDA of about $100 million before central costs of about $13 million. So we're running at about 85 to 90 million of EBITDA pre-COVID. What we've seen so far this year is a very strong January. We were up 40 to 45%, depending on what metric you looked at, organically last year. Deals put us into 200, 300% growth. So about 40 to 45% growth. And January was up by 33%. February was similarly strong, a little bit less, but similarly strong because of the impact of COVID in Asia. We haven't had our March numbers yet, but we have seen little impact as yet. Our content business, 70% of our business has held firm in terms of our forecast so far. Our programmatic business has been affected a little bit more, but marginally, probably about 5%, 10% of their revenues, which account for about 30% of the total. So that's against budget. And of course, we were budgeting a very significant increase because we've laid out our three-year plan for 19 to 21, and that was to double the size of the company, both from a revenue point of view, net revenue point of view, and profit point of view, EBITDA point of view. And we've revised that plan for 20 to 22. And despite COVID, we're sticking to that objective of doubling the size of the company organically over those 3 years. So from 20 to 22, which implies, if you do your maths, about a 24% consolidated rate or compound growth rate. You can see that the cash flow remains very strong. Our cash flow is probably about 100% conversion. The agency business, the consulting business, does convert to cash, basically. So strong cash flow, and you can see that exhibited in our numbers. So to summarize, before we open up the questions, Andrew, very strong gross profit, bottom line organic growth in 2019. Strong cash flow and a strong balance sheet, which is particularly important going into COVID. We're targeting to double the size of the company organically within 3 years from 20 to 22. Made a good start to 2020, but we have to be realistic about COVID. We think the shape, maybe I'm being too optimistic, but the shape is either V-shaped or at worst, I would say a reverse square root sign, meaning a sharp fall, but a significant recovery thereafter. And I think we'll see that significant recovery as we go through Q3 and into Q4 and 2021. We've taken strong cost action, not on our people. That's the last resort. We've cut out non-essential costs. We've not ceased hiring completely because we still have significant growth in various areas, but we've restrained hiring, and we've taken all the actions you would take in reduction of travel, obviously, which has gone away, and associated costs. And we've got a healthy merger pipeline for strategic add-ons. We'll probably be doing two data and analytics add-ons, one in Latin America, one in Asia Pacific. We've signed exclusives for that. And then also something in Germany, which is around four major pitches that we have going on at the moment. Two of them are in Germany. One is global, the two others are global. The ones in Germany are European, Western Europe, covering Germany, France, Italy, Spain, and the UK. To sum up, I think we've achieved brand awareness. We have very strong brand awareness in the industry and brand trial with our clients in 2019, but we need now conversion at scale. We have two whoppers, Google, and defining a whopper as more than 5% of our revenues, and the telecoms company that I referred to. We have two whoppers, but we need to get more conversion at scale, and the pitches and the land and expand strategy enable us to do that. And we have, as I say, and finally in the slide, a number of major clients opportunities in development. So that's the presentation, Andrew.
So, Martin, look, thanks very much indeed. Look, worth pointing out, just before we get to the questions, at least 700, 800 people connected watching tonight. So a lot of interest in S4 and what you're up to and what the plans are. I suppose a couple of really interesting questions here. What are your thoughts, Sir Martin, on in-game advertising? Is there any opportunities there? Is this something that you've thought about?
Yeah, I mean, in-game advertising. Can you still hear me, Andrew?
We can. We can hear you, Martin. Sir Martin, but we can't see you at the moment.
I'm turning the lights off. Not yet, anyway. So I'll carry on if you can hear me. You hear me all right, yes?
We can hear you. We can.
Okay, fine. So I would say in-game advertising is very interesting. And when I was at WPP, actually, we looked at it quite closely. We often worried about the nature of the inventory and whether the inventory was as valuable as the game companies thought it was. But the answer to the question is obviously with COVID, we're seeing greater activity. And we've seen in our own business a switch to automation and AI and animation. Animation has literally exploded. And I was listening to somebody from the movie industry talk about the impact of COVID on Hollywood and animation. And Hollywood has been slow to adapt to new technology. And we've seen animation take off in the last 4 or 5 weeks. It was important before. So robotics, automation, animation, important. And the gaming industry obviously has benefited from people working from home and increased attention. And coming out of COVID, we think there will be more working from home, more flexibility in working hours. And we see tremendous impact at three levels of COVID. It will accelerate digital transformation and business transformation at three levels. Firstly, at the consumer level. You know, we're living with technology as we are here. We're battling with it in some cases as we are here, but we're living with it. We're communicating more with one another through social media and video and search, etc. We're buying more online and we're educating our children online. So that's one level. Second level would be media owners. Media owners will switch more from analog to digital. Bizarre example maybe is Jewish Chronicle went out of business, one of the oldest newspapers here in the UK, I think 1867. Had ceased its paper version. A number of other papers and magazines are doing that. I don't believe they will come back post-COVID. I think you'll see a switch by media owners even faster to digital. And then finally, and probably most importantly, enterprise managers, that is managers of mainly listed uncontrolled companies, where there's diffusion of control and a separation of control from management. The average CEO lasts about 5 years in those companies, and probably was hesitant to make major structural change, which digital transformation needs, when things were going okay, when they were not going too badly. You know, pre the G2 spat between China and the US, pre COVID, obviously pre the oil price, the production issues that we saw with Saudi and Russia, and things were okay. You didn't want to disturb the apple cart. Now all bets are off. Q2 will be extremely difficult, and we'll see. What I think we will see is embracing digital transformation. So Andrew, I think that the future broadened the question from in gaming advertising. There will be an opportunity there. And there will be a significant opportunity driven by some of the things that we're seeing through COVID.
So, Martin, this is a bit of an interesting one. What about the risks or the threat from what we're seeing at the moment, influencer marketing and advertising on the likes of Twitter, Instagram, you name it, you know, as opposed to digital? How concerned about
well,
that?
Well, yeah, well, influencer is, let me just take you through to the slide. We have a very significant influencer practice. We see influencer as being part of digital. We think it's tended to have been fragmented. And you'll see pretty much in the middle, in August of 2019, we brought IMA, which is called Influencer Marketing Agency, run by three women, based in Amsterdam. who expanded into the United States, backed by a private equity company, specifically backed women entrepreneurs. Very bright people, very, very aggressive and in a good way, and successful in the influence area. And we see that as a key part. That's not a threat. That's part of what we do. But we see it as a subpart, a part of what we do, and a very important part. And a very interesting in relation to the question, we've seen in COVID, C19, evidence that clients are increasingly using influencer advertising or influencers to advertise. Now, we specialize not in the top one, not the celebrity influencers. We think there are some challenges in that area. We specialize in the 99% that we think consumers more easily identify with. So we have that as a fundamental part of our content practice and our programmatic practice, and we've expanded IMA beyond Amsterdam and beyond New York to all our offices in 30 countries around the world.
So, Martin, what about the longer term ambitions here? I mean, we've had an interesting question in tonight. Is WPP within your sights, perhaps?
That's whoever asked that question is being cheeky. The problem with WPP, and I still suffer with other WPP shareholders. I still have 2% of WPP to my chagrin. And that's probably because I can't be subjective about it. As I've always said, that when you start a company, it's as close as a man can come to giving birth, not physically, but mentally. And probably I haven't been able to shake that off. But having said that, I think WPP is saddled with a traditional business that COVID, C19, is ravaging more intensely, and that will, when it comes out of C19, or when we come out of it towards the end of this year, will, I think, suffer even more. So, I think the future of WPP, its market value, to throw something into the mix, I believe is well below its breakup value. I'm surprised that no private equity or activist investor has not got, forget about WPP, let's talk about the six holdcos. Maybe not so much Omnicom, which probably is currently the best run. Maybe IG as well. Havas has disappeared into Vivendi. Publicis is having tremendous troubles. I mean, if you look at the price charts, and I compare them every day to the progress of S4, Vivendi probably has been the best performer. We've been better than all of them, then Omnicom, then IPG. And at the bottom, you've got Publicis and Dentsu, which really have had great, great difficulty. Publicis, Dentsu, and WPP. Those three have been locked together at the bottom. And the reason they are, and I think probably the reason why PE and activists have not got in, is they're worried about the structural challenges that the traditional agencies face. And we have the advantage at S4 that we had a clean sheet of paper little under 2 years ago, and we could pick out the three growth sectors. I mean, I looked when I left WPP, WPP's portfolio even then was not showing growth, but there were parts of it that were growing. And the three parts that were growing were first party data, digital content, advertising content, and programmatic. Those are the three areas. So, we're blessed, if I can put it that way, being in the growth sectors. That's what S4 is about. S4 is about top growth with good margins. WPP was about globalization and the beginnings of technology. And such before that, which where I was CFO, was about globalization. What S was about is focusing on top line growth. And the reason for that is analysts and investors place a premium on top line, what retailers would call like for like same store growth. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to focus on those areas, not sacrificing margin to do that. We think margin's an important part. But you know, one of the things that we learned at WPP is the market, at least to date, has valued organic growth more highly than necessarily margin. And we're balancing the two. I don't want anybody to think we're not. And we think 20% EBITDA margins are maintainable, you know, where we are and in the future if we pick those areas very carefully. But we are focused, coming back to the question, we are focused on the new. We don't want to go back to the future. That's not what we're seeking to do.
So, Martin, if I can ask you briefly, just one final question here. These deals that you've done, why do you refer to them as mergers and not acquisitions? And essentially, you've gone out and bought companies.
Well, the first statement or question that I ask any of the partners that we bring in the discussions that I'm involved in, and Scott Spirit, who's our growth officer, Peter Rademacher, who's our CFO, and Victor and Wes, who run Victor Knapp and Wesley Tahar, who run Media Monks, and Pete Kim and Chris Martin, who run Mighty Hive. Those are Michelle de Reich, who runs Asia. Those are the sort of top eight people in the company. The first question we ask anybody who wants to join us is, if you want to sell your company, we say, don't bother. I mean, or do you want to sell your company? If you do, don't bother with us. Take it no further. There's no point in us having any further conversations. We want people who are going to buy in, not sell out, or worse, sell in to our concept of building that new era, new age, media, advertising and marketing company. And if you believe in that, if you want to do that, and there's a disintermediation disruption objective too. If you're prepared to do that, to buy into our concept and to buy into the idea of disintermediation and disruption, then you're for us. In all the things that we've done, and we've done 11 things in just under a couple of years, we never were the top brick off the chimney in terms of price. I think Pete Kim said today on an investor call that we had that he had 30 bids for Mighty Hive. We were not the best bid financially. We were the best bid operationally and strategically for the future. And we all believe in that. So the structure of our deal is not an earnout. We think earnouts create unnecessary fragmentation. We have to build one firm, a unitary firm. So we offer half shares, half cash, basically, with lockups for a couple of years. And the philosophy is you join us and you work together with us as one. Because all the holding companies that the previous question referred to, one of which was WPP, suffer from being too vertical. When I was at WPP, I used that terrible word horizontality, which I think has been banned now as a word. But the objective there was to create one firm. The trouble is it's too difficult. It's too complex. You have to blow the company up to create it. So to create that one firm. So that's the reason we call it mergers. These are not acquisitions. These are people that are joining us on a journey, on a mission. And that's what we're here to do.
So, Martin, look, thanks very much indeed for your time. Really appreciate it. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you very much for the opportunity. And thanks, everybody, the 300 or 400 or 500, whatever it is, that have tuned in.
I think we're closer to 800 at the moment, Sir Martin. But
fantastic. Well done.
They're creeping up as the minutes go on. And hopefully, I'm keeping my fingers crossed here, that we've got Gabriele Cerrone on the line from Tiziana. Gabriele, is there any chance that you can hear us? Can we see you? Can we hear you? Not quite yet. Well, I can see him. Gabriele. It might have been too good to be true. We can see him, but we can't hear him. We could hear him before, but we can't hear him now. Look, that's really unfortunate. He had a lot of. He was going to run us through the company profile and what the plans are. Look, he's working on it frantically. We might give him an extra couple of minutes. Have we got Have we got Cathal or Ray still with us? We've got
Scott. Yeah.
We've got both. Look, both of them listening enthusiastically to the previous presentations. Look, if we can, Cathal. Look, Ray, we'll get to you in a moment. But Cathal, look, we've literally been inundated, as I was saying before, as to certain questions and what you're up to. What's the deal as far as ventilators? Where your quarantine unit and your facility there? I mean, just tell us a little bit about what you're doing there.
Yeah, I saw that question, Andrew. Very good one. Somebody put the query, and I just see here: have we ventilators? Of course we have. The 24 bed quarantine clinic is a luxury private hospital. Being honest with you, we have everything from all emergency response units, ventilators, everything. However, I know some people are questioned, worried, are you guys bringing live COVID-19 into the lab? No, no chance. Not coming anywhere close to us. What we are looking at doing is an attenuated, big word, can't pronounce it, version of COVID-19. That would be the virus slimmed down and the nasty bits genetically taken out. So I think the question is, people are worried that, look, the clinic has a lot of RSV work, which is it's a bigger opportunity, believe it or not, RSV vaccine. We've got three different trials coming down the track in that area, flu work. So I think the question was, if something went wrong, do we have ventilators? And the question is, we're part of Queen Mary's Hospital. There's an emergency unit next door to us. We've been doing trials since 1989. There's never been once, it was called a red action. That was once when we actually had to call a serious doctor instance. Bear in mind what we're doing. We're giving the patients a mild version of any one of the 8 diseases. And the reason the knowledge is so important, it takes 4 years to grow this virus that it won't cause harm, but it replicates the real wild version. So I think that's where that question and ventilators come. Yes, we have. We don't have many. As like every other private establishment, we're making them available to the NHS if they need them. They're there. But there's only a handful of them, and they know, like all of our equipment, our lab equipment has been made available as well, and we're offering at the moment is to run COVID trials if necessary as well.
It's probably worth just reminding, I mean, you and I have spoken in the past, but the team that you've got there, I mean, these are world leaders when it comes to virology and vaccines and infectious diseases.
Yeah, look, the founder is Professor John Oxford. He wrote the book 2 years ago on coronavirus. This is quite ironic. That's why we started the coronavirus challenge study model 2 years ago. He was worrying this thing is worth watching. If you Google him, his book, the front page, the cover is, guess what? Not alone is the coronavirus, it's the Wuhan coronavirus. And he was concerned about that particular type of coronavirus 2 years ago. But yeah, look, they're a great team. It was the first person that was licensed in Europe to bring SARS into the UK to have it analysed in our laboratory. That was 9 years ago. So there's a lot of skills. We will absolutely do nothing that will endanger that facility, that laboratory. Our chief scientist, Andrew Catchpole, who has been on BBC Breakfast, he's been on CNBC. We push him out. He's much more photogenic than me. He knows what he's doing. He's a Doc Phil from Oxford. And guess what? Influenza virus replication. Isn't that an ironic? He's been one of his first 17 years.
Look, he sounds like he knows what he's doing. You mentioned a bit earlier, Cathal, about the exit strategy for Open Orphan. I mean, what kind of market cap, what kind of share price are you looking at?
Look, I've said that, look, we're very conscious that we've a lot of now loyal retail shareholders. They would like us to move even faster. I think we moved pretty fast. We did the fastest takeover of one AIM company or one London Stock Exchange company off another in 7.5 years, 34 days from maybe the first offer of HVivo till we closed it. We're moving pretty fast. Yeah, people would like to see us move faster. People would like to see more contracts. And I know from the questions, where the hell are the monthly contracts? We announced one last month. Watch this space. Trust me, they're not far away. Genuinely, as I said, anybody, Sir Martin mentioned, COVID is affecting every business. The shutdown isn't causing a major problem, but getting contract signs is taking several weeks longer. We're dealing with lawyers on our side, lawyers on the other side. That does take us. So yeah, I think people would like to see us sign more contracts, sign them faster. That, we say, is work in progress.
Can you hear me? It's about contracts, getting them signed, deals done.
Can you hear me?
Can you
hear me?
Interruption. We can hear. Gabriele.
Okay, great.
Well, Gabriele, he's made contact.
Yes.
Gabriele, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Well done. Excellent. Well, look, I think the plan is, Thomas, have we got Cathal? Look, I'm sure you won't mind the interruption. Ray, you won't neither. Gabriele, would you mind if we, Thomas, have you got Gabriele's presentation handy? He does. He does indeed. Look, Gabriele, we've got it here. We're ready. We're waiting. We're listening. I mean, if you can, just talk us through it. Remind us, assume we don't necessarily all are up to speed with what you're doing. So take us back to square one. Remind us about Tiziana, what you're about and what you're doing.
Sure. So I'm the chairman and founder of Tiziana Life Sciences. We are a publicly traded biotech company in the UK, as well as a NASDAQ market in the US. Our focus is on immunology and oncology. And we are have a platform of small molecules and a main focus of antibody, monoclonal antibody development. I'll move to discuss our team. So what I believe is a quite distinguished characteristic of Tiziana is not only do we have an exceptional team of researchers, but we actually have researchers who have taken products from the bench laboratory onto the market as FDA approved drugs. And I think that is a very difficult characteristic to find in terms of team and management for small companies like us that have only 100 million pound valuations. So I will start by discussing my CEO and Chief Scientific Officer, Dr. Kanwar Shalubai. Dr. Kanwar Shalubai not only is the discovery scientist, but he brought to the market what is considered now one of the world's best drugs for irritable bowel syndrome and chronic constipation. It was FDA approved 3 years ago, and Shalu was the sole inventor of this drug. And he has a strong history of being able to create next generation and better version analogs of existing classes of drugs by often improving the side effect profile, as he did with his invention of planarTECH, as it became the drug with the best diarrhea profile out of all of the constipation drugs on the market. So he has a proven track record. As for myself, I've started 9 biotech companies, eight of which were therapeutic companies and 1 diagnostic company, and all 8 of the companies were publicly listed between Europe and the United States, and only 1 of the 9 companies has not made it onto the public markets right now. Of the 8 listed companies that I took public, 2 of the companies exceeded $2 billion valuation peak, of which 1 of the companies, Inhibitech, was sold to Bristol-Myers Squibb for $2.5 billion in a record price back in 2012. In addition to that, I personally have had the experience in repurposing a drug to address a public pandemic emergency. Not pandemics such as COVID-19, but when the 9/11 attack occurred in 2001, there was a big fear of bioterrorism. And at that time, there was a company that had co-founded and was chairman and director of a majority shareholder called Sega Technologies, which was an antiviral company developing drugs for influenza and strep throat. Because we had a strong R&D team, we decided to repurpose some of our R&D into treating the smallpox virus, which was a potential treacherous weapon that terrorists could use to annihilate mass numbers of people in subways or in any large gathering center. So this project which we initiated shortly thereafter the 9/11 attack, ended up becoming the first drug antidote approved by the FDA and the first drug antidote to be purchased by the American government under the BARDA's BioShield program in a multi-billion dollar stock contract, of which $628 million was drawn down on back in 2018. So we have experience of getting drugs at the early discovery level stages and getting them onto the market and getting them sold, which I think is a very distinguishing trait to have as a small startup company. Just continuing on with our distinguished team, one of our key partners in developing our antibody portfolio is Dr. Howard Weiner. Dr. Howard Weiner is the head of the Mitt and Ann Romney Medical Center for Multiple Sclerosis at the Harvard's Brigham and Women Center. And he is considered probably the most distinguished key opinion leader in multiple sclerosis. And obviously, as you can imagine, he treats Mitt Romney's wife. Hence, he's the head of the Romney MS Center at Harvard. He's also very distinguished for his work in Alzheimer's disease. And another one of our collaborators, Dr. Napoleone Ferrara, is the inventor of the best time all time selling drug for tumors for cancer, known as Avastin. It's a monoclonal antibody which he developed when he was at invented and developed while he was at Genentech, and which later was acquired by Roche. And Avastin has done a circa $7 billion average a year for the last 12 years. So we have put together a very elite team that knows how to bring inventions from the laboratory bench to the market. Here's a look at our capital structure table. We have primary shares outstanding are circa 154 million, just under that. Fully diluted, we have 179 million circa. So our market cap is just in excess of 110 million fully diluted pounds. So let me take you through some of the investment highlights as I refer to them in the company. So one of the biggest focuses at Tiziana Life Sciences in our quite robust pipeline for a small company is our monoclonal antibody portfolio. We are a team that strongly believes in the history tends to repeat itself, whether it's on quality of management or on the class of drugs that are out in the market. And I think it is very hard to argue that monoclonal antibodies have become, in the last 25 years, probably one of the most successful classes of drugs. The largest selling drug today in the world is Humira, which is owned by AbbVie. And this past year, it exceeded over $22.5 billion in turnover, the biggest selling drug in the history of the pharma business. And it's a monoclonal antibody. In addition to that, Avastin, which our board member invented, has done in excess of $7 billion average a year. Remicade has done close to $10 billion a year. And we have a list of successful stories with monoclonal antibodies. So we believe that having the history of drugs in a class such as monoclonal antibodies, which are safe and have shown efficacy, is the right space to be concentrating our efforts in. So what Tiziana is trying to pioneer is we are trying to pioneer the first oral and nasal delivery of what is known as a CD3 antibody. So we have the patent on the composition of matter patent, which we acquired from Novimmune, which gives us protection on the antibody itself. And we've developed our own proprietary formulation patent in delivering it in a different untraditional way. The different untraditional way is delivering it orally and nasally. as historically, monoclonal antibodies have been delivered or intravenous or subcutaneously, but primarily intravenously. So the advantage we believe, which is a life game changer for delivering a fully human anti-CD3 antibody such as ourselves, is that we believe that delivering it orally or nasally alleviates the side effect issues you can have with infusion. So we have begun our journey over 2 years ago with going through the clinical process. So both our oral formulation for delivering CD3 antibody, as well as our capsule, we've developed a capsule for the oral delivery, which we've completed in our phase 1 trial for Crohn's disease. And we've developed also a nasal formulation for progressive multiple sclerosis. Okay, both trials have completed, and they showed a very, very exemplary side effect profile. In fact, our oral capsules were taken up to 5 mg, and we showed no toxicity. So we're very excited about that. And now we are going to bring these two programs into the clinic, hopefully as early as the end of May, early June, depending when lockdowns finish. We will bring in our oral and nasal delivery systems onto the market in the clinical trials. So just moving on to how our oral versus nasal works. I'll begin discussing the nasal, as the approach is that Treg cells that are capable of crossing the blood-brain barrier through our technology will be able to treat diseases which have had very little success in commercial drug world, such as multiple sclerosis and Alzheimer's. We believe that our technology, which allows the nasal formulation to go through the nasal cavity and crossing the blood-brain barrier, will allow us to stimulate Tregs, which are essential in combating diseases such as multiple sclerosis. Having obviously the key opinion leader in the world, such as Dr. Howard Weiner at Harvard, to invent and see us through the clinical trials is a priceless asset for Tiziana Life Sciences. So this past history and success that we've had in taking monoclonal antibodies, such as our oral and nasal, and for reformulating them, has been a key experience in allowing us to apply it in the most recent announcement we've made with our COVID-19 program. Let me just jump over. So what we've done in our delivery, proprietary delivery technology that Dr. Kanwar Shalubai, our CEO, invented, we've taken antibodies which start off as solutions, and we've turned them into both enteric capsules, coated capsules, and also into a nasal formulation. And so we have the past history, which now is proven to be safe and effective. And in the case of our in our nasal phase 1, we also set up biomarkers to see if there was any Treg modifications. And in that trial, not only did it show exemplary safety results, but we also saw increase in Treg activity, which is a hint that it could be efficacious against multiple sclerosis. So we know that our reformulation of antibodies works in from a safety perspective and in a delivery perspective. So we've taken this background and intellectual property and know-how and applied it into developing our handheld device, which is a nebulizer inhaler for treating COVID-19 patients, using our other antibody, which is the anti-IL-6R antibody, which we are in a partnership agreement with Bristol-Myers Squibb. Bristol Myers Squibb acquired years ago Medirex, which was the pioneer in developing a technology to create completely fully human antibodies. And so they were acquired by Bristol Myers, and Medirex and Novimmune, prior to the Bristol Myers acquisition, had a partnership agreement in developing both the antibodies that we bought, anti-CD3 and our IL-6R, which we're developing for COVID. And hence, after the acquisitions, our partner, royalty partner on this deal is now Bristol Myers Squibb. I'm going to move forward to our COVID slide and then move back, since we're discussing COVID, and I'll just come back. Here we go. So as you may have followed, on March 11th, the company announced that it was going to expedite development of its anti-IL-6R drug, TZLS501, to treat COVID-19. We came up with a plan when we saw the successful data in an Italian hospital in Naples, where two patients had a very successful response with the use of Roche's drug Actemra. When we saw the mechanism of action of Roche's drug Actemra, that it was an anti-IL-6 drug, we quickly figured out that we were sitting on a very interesting pathway to treating COVID-19. We believe, however, that we have three characteristics which distinguish us from the two other well-known anti-IL-6 which are being used currently for COVID-19. One of them, as I mentioned, is Roche's Actemra. The second is Sanofi's Kevzara. So both of those drugs are administered intravenously. And we believe that with our new delivery system, which is an inhaler nebulizer, we could deliver our anti-IL-6 directly to the lungs. So the advantage to that is you can provide immediate relief to a patient who is having a hyper cytokine storm and you know, risking quick mortality. As you know, most of the mortalities associated with COVID-19 occur from the organ malfunction of the lungs. So lungs have a difficult time circulating oxygen because of the inflammation that IL-6, which is known as interleukin-6, causes. So our drug, like Kevzara and Roche's Actemra, is an anti-IL-6. We fight inflammation, but we believe with our proprietary oral and nasal inhaler nebulizer device, we can deliver our anti-IL-6 drug quicker, because we'll deliver it directly to the lungs as opposed to only intravenously. We will use it intravenously when we believe that the patient needs to also treat other organs if it's gone past the lungs and could cause other organ failure, such as kidney, heart, or liver. So I have a picture, a slide up of some of the processes of progression of COVID-19. And you have your early response. Some patients who have a strong immune system will be asymptomatic. The other unlucky ones will have fast viral proliferation, which then will transform into hyperinflammation in the lungs with cytokine storm. And you see that the IL-6, and as I highlighted in the slide, TNF, which is known as tumor necrosis factor, are the two main culprits in bringing inflammation to the lung, which then causes mortality. So So here's a slide partially reiterating what I just mentioned. I will but follow up on the other two distinguished characteristics that we believe that we have when comparing ourselves to Actemra and Casevra. So we believe that we have a very effective approach to rapidly deplete excessive levels of IL-6 in the lungs. We also are a fully human monoclonal antibody as opposed to a humanized, which means it's derived from mice. We believe that will enable us to have less immune responses from patients because it's more similar to the human system. And we believe that we are the only IL-6 receptor monoclonal antibody that rapidly depletes circulating levels of IL-6 in the blood. So the proprietary inhalation technology will give us, we believe, a quicker and immediate relief to the lungs, which can avoid mortality. Another advantage of our device is we believe that because nebulizers are easy to use for elderly patients from which COVID unfortunately has struck the most severe, nebulizers are very easy to handle. And if someone is not in an ICU unit, it could be a big advantage for either younger children or elderly populations to administer the anti-IL-6 drug. I'm going to move back to our other programs that we're developing in our antibody portfolio. Okay, so here we go. So one of our main focuses, as we believe it addresses one of the biggest markets in the world, because monoclonal antibodies, as we've seen from Humira, often have the advantage of treating more than one indication. Hence, you see drugs such as Humira, which don't only work in psoriasis, but it works in Crohn's and arthritis. Hence, they've been able to become the world's biggest selling drug with 23 billion circa in sales. And this is because you can use it on different applications, different drug indications. So we believe that our anti-CD3 monoclonal antibody has the same potential in to be applied to different disease indications. So, for example, we are developing starting our phase 2 trial shortly with an oral capsule for Crohn's disease. Crohn's disease is a disease which currently does not have a met need in terms of cures or strong efficacies, and therefore we believe that a successful and safe monoclonal antibody such as anti-CD3 could be a game changer for the market. I also would like to highlight, there has never been a anti-CD3 drug delivered in a format that is not intravenous or subcutaneous. So we would be the first ones in the world to have ever delivered a anti-CD3 monoclonal antibody nasally and orally. And again, the big advantage of this is we believe it alleviates the side effects which are associated with an injectable intravenous anti-CD3 monoclonal antibody. So hence, with our formulation technology, patented formulation technology, we will be able to deliver it safely and treat some of the biggest markets in the world. In addition to Crohn's disease, we are also going to be developing the drug subsequently for NASH. As you may know, NASH is fatty liver disease. It's another inflammatory disease. It's one of the biggest growing disease indications in the Western world, primarily because of obesity and bad diets in Western countries such as the United States, United Kingdom, and Germany. But it's prevalent in all of Europe and the United States, but growing exponentially. It is a massive market, and we plan to develop our drug for Magulab in Crohn's, in NASH, once we've demonstrated successful proof of concept in Crohn's. As you can imagine, we don't have the resources to develop all the programs simultaneously. So we believe the Crohn's indication is the most low-hanging fruit of all of the clinical indications out there. And so what we want to show the scientific community is that we can demonstrate proof of concept after we've just demonstrated safety last year. And together with the successful safety profile we've already exhibited last year, and potentially a successful efficacy trial in the end of this year and early 2021, we will have potentially a blockbuster drug on our hand, which could be used in multiple disease indications, as I mentioned, including our nasal format for multiple sclerosis and also potentially Alzheimer's disease. So multiple sclerosis and Alzheimer's disease are neurodegenerative diseases, and hence the nasal formulation would be the way that we'd like to attack that, by alleviating the common obstacle of blood-brain barrier progression, which most drugs have today to treat neurodegenerative diseases. Here's another slide just showing you how our technology works inside the gut. So let me talk to you a little bit about what is probably undoubtedly the most important asset a biotech company can have: intellectual property. So we have a strong patent portfolio, and our patent portfolio is both on our biological antibody itself, so composition of matter patent on our antibody itself, anti-CD3, as well as our anti-IL-6, which we're developing for COVID-19. And in addition to that, we have composition of matter formulation patents, the patents that Dr. Kanwar Shalubai developed in order to deliver these, both of these antibodies, in a more safe and immediate effective way to human patients. So just running down the patent estate, you can see here the number of the patent dockets, and that they're patented for uses in diseases such as Crohn's, NASH, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's disease, and others. So I brought up briefly earlier that we conducted a phase one clinical trial last year at Brigham and Women's Hospital at Harvard University. It was a dose-ranging, double-blinded, placebo-controlled study in healthy subjects. Formalin was administered nasally, and we took it up to 250 grams using our handheld spray device. We exhibited an exemplary safety profile, and thanks to these results, we've been able to proceed now to our phase two program.
Gabriele, yes. Not to interrupt here, Gabriele, just a couple of minutes if you can, and then we'll get to some questions.
I will move quicker down to. This is just a quick presentation on our phase 2B ready drug for liver cancer. So it's been in circa 300 human patients. We will be enrolling this coming year, closer to the beginning of 2021, a phase 2B trial where we will be developing a combination trial with an existing liver cancer drug, which is approved in combination with ours. We've demonstrated one of the best profiles from a safety perspective and quality of life when comparing our liver drug to others on the market right now. And so we will be proceeding to a phase 2B combination trial next year. So a couple of upcoming catalytic events, which I think our listeners may be interested in. So on May 13th, we have the American Society of Cancer and Oncology, which is referred to as ASCO, May 13th. Tiziana will be presenting. So I think that could be an interesting day for many companies like us in the oncology field. We also have our initiation of our clinical trial, which will be either at the end of May or early June, depending on when the lockdown starts for our anti-CD3 monoclonal antibody. And proceed. In addition to our programs that I mentioned earlier, Yale University is collaborating with us in developing our anti-CD3 drug for juvenile type 1 diabetes. And we've included on our presentation a paper that was published showing how a similar antibody had a successful clinical trial. That's it, Andrew. So if you have any questions.
Well, look, Gabriele, I mean, as you alluded to there, I mean, you've been in the news recently, loads of talk around coronavirus, COVID-19 and what you're up to. But of course, you've got such a massive meaty pipeline as far as your other antibody portfolio. I mean, we will talk a bit more about COVID in a moment, but remind us sort of what's coming up, what the plans are as far as what's not happening as far as COVID's concerned, where you've got Crohn's, MS and the like.
Sure. So again, we have two pathways. Our nasal formulation product for our anti-CD3 is going to be developed for neurodegenerative diseases such as multiple sclerosis. We're starting that phase 2 trial. Lead indication is progressive multiple sclerosis. And the oral capsule form will be for Crohn's disease. So we have both of those phase 2 trials that are going to be initiated. And we believe that the potential successful result of either an oral version of a fully humanized antibody, fully human antibody, such as CD3 for such a big market would be perhaps the biggest catalytic event for this company.
How's the, I mean, Gabriele, you've got a lot going on. How's the financing, the funding from that perspective to just see you through all the work that you're doing? I mean, are you fairly comfortable at the moment?
Well, you know, as you know, in biotech, there's never enough money. There's always a need to continue to raise money. At the current moment, we believe that we have sufficient capital to get to some of our clinical catalytic points. We will raise money when there's a great opportunity, but right now we don't have to if the right opportunity doesn't present itself in terms of a good offering at a good valuation for investors. We believe that the catalytic event that we could have towards the end of this year or first quarter 2021 in our anti-CD3 program for both Crohn's and multiple sclerosis are huge game changers. And we believe that showing that we would be the first company on the planet to deliver a non-intravenous version of a human antibody would make us a very interesting acquisition target.
I think it's been it's been a fairly drastic sunset in your part of London.
Yeah, I gotta move over so you can see me.
If you got a light that you can turn. Sure. So, I mean, it's lovely to hear from you, but it's always nice to see you.
Yeah, sure. Let's move over.
I mean, we've got the silhouette happening there, but it'll be nice to.
Sure. Here you go.
Yeah, just pop, flick the switch if you can.
Yep.
There we go. That's a bit better.
Okay.
I mean, so Gabriele, what are your intentions? You mentioned it a bit earlier about AIM, NASDAQ. Are you still looking to remain dual listed? What's your thinking at the moment?
So as we've announced, we announced a plan months ago to migrate the company as a single listed company on the NASDAQ, because there was very little volume on the AIM exchange, and we were finding it quite confusing to have complicated to have two listings when there was no liquidity on one of the listings. Obviously, recently that's changed dramatically, and our board will evaluate in the next month on whether we may want to change the date of the listing from the AIM.
There's been a couple of questions tonight just around the delivery method and the nebulization here. I mean, have you collated a certain amount of independent valuation and review just to how effective this is?
Well, so obviously we've done that in our other indications, as I mentioned earlier in my presentation. So we've proven that we know how to lyophilize and stabilize a monoclonal antibody. A monoclonal antibody start off in solution form, and with our technology, we were able to lyophilize and stabilize them in one format, which became an enteric capsule, so a capsule format to be taken orally, and the other one to be inhaled in our nasal device. So we've shown by our successful phase one trials for both Crohn's nasally and, I'm sorry, Crohn's orally and our MS safety trial nasally, that we know how to reformulate and administer antibodies. So we're going to use the same exact technology and know-how to deliver our anti-IL-6R drug through our device, our handheld nebulizer.
And just as far as advancing these clinical trials any further, I mean, how much attention are you paying to, say, Sanofi's drug and the clinical trials and studies they're doing, and to whether or not the element of success that they have as to whether or not you continue going here? I mean, how important is that for you?
So we're following very closely, especially Roche's drug, because Roche's drug has been FDA approved for almost a decade now. It is a decade for rheumatoid arthritis. And as I mentioned in my first interview with you, we originally acquired our anti-IL-6 drug, TZLS501, to develop it for rheumatoid arthritis and multiple myeloma, because those are other diseases where interleukin-6 has a big role. So Roche's drug was approved a decade ago for rheumatoid arthritis. It's a safe drug compared to drugs such as hydroxychloroquine, which is the famous Trump therapy. And so we're following it. And what we believe is very encouraging for Tiziana Life Sciences is that although the Roche drug was FDA approved for rheumatoid arthritis, it has already been expedited approved by the FDA and the Chinese government for use in COVID-19. It's probably one of the quickest FDA approvals for a different use I've ever seen in my 26 years in biotech. So we believe that although we're much earlier than Roche, we can get the same type of expedited acceleration from government agencies, so we could pull the drug through the clinical system much quicker than if it would have been a rheumatoid arthritis drug, drastically different. So we believe the pathway could be extremely sped by government agencies who want to get COVID treatments out there. And we believe that having a drug antidote will continue to be essential, notwithstanding a successful vaccine, because we believe that most of the population will not be vaccinated even if there is a successful vaccine. As we've seen with the influenza, there's been a vaccine for close to two decades, and the large majority of the population does not get vaccinated for that. So we think having a drug antidote to respond to emergencies, especially in younger populations that may not fall into the vaccine regimen, is going to be essential to saving mortality from COVID-19.
Gabriele, did you say a bit earlier that you're doing some work with Bristol Myers?
Well, no, Bristol Myers is our royalty partner on our anti-IL-6 our receptor COVID-19. So we have to pay milestones and royalties to Bristol Myers Squibb based on the success of the product, because Medarex was acquired by Bristol Myers, and so we have a partnership agreement on a royalty and milestone basis with Bristol Myers for our COVID project, as well as our eventual rheumatoid arthritis project with our anti-IL-6.
Well, look, that's clearly an endorsement for what you're doing and the value in some of these assets, clearly.
Yeah, we feel that we've, again, as I mentioned earlier in my interview, our team, Dr. Kanwar Shulubai, Dr. Howard Weiner, individuals and scientists like Napoleon have brought drugs from the bench onto the market with FDA approvals, and we're going to try to do it again with our antibody portfolio.
Gabriele, just say we're almost at the end here, but a couple of questions, a few people wanting to know about the RNS a couple of days back about the equity headroom, $20 million, I believe it was. Just run us through what that was, just in terms of should you need additional firepower in future. Just talk us through some of the detail of that announcement.
Sure. So the ATM facility, which refers to at the market, is a facility which we found in the past to be a very successful instrument and program for accessing capital when the right opportunity presents itself, because you're not faced with the lengthy and bureaucratic steps with a traditional investment banking transaction, where they have to take you on a roadshow, do due diligence, have you meet 500 investors. So we believe having an instrument such as the ATM available to us, given all of the catalytic events we have coming in the year 2020, is a key instrument for financing our research and development of the drugs.
Well, look, very good. I know time's pushing on here, Gabriele, but as far as what you're doing and the pipeline and you're pushing it forward, do you reckon that industry's taking notice of what you're doing and you could be a decent takeover target at some point in the near term?
So again, on COVID-19, it's such a new disease to the market. I couldn't comment on where we'd have to be and what the, you know, M&A appetite would be for diseases such as COVID-19, because as everyone knows, most of the drug companies such as Johnson & Johnson that are developing vaccines are not planning to charge huge margins on these drugs. So I can't predict whether there'll be M&A frenzies on small companies that develop successful unique products. However, that being said, I do believe that if we show a successful proof of concept trial for Crohn's disease in phase two, that we would be a very, very major target for M&A, because we would be the first company on the planet that ever delivered a oral anti-CD3 antibody in a successful clinical trial. So we would be the first in class, you know, first to ever deliver it non-intravenous. And that also remains for our nasal trial for our multiple sclerosis and eventually Alzheimer's. If that is successful, that would drive huge M&A interest for two reasons. First in class, because we're being the pioneers to deliver antibodies, you know, an antibody non-intravenously. And number two, we're addressing the big mammoth markets: Crohn's disease, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's, NASH. You know, the big mammoth markets. When you're looking at mammoth market indications, all of the big pharmas have you on the M&A list. If you deliver the data, they come for you.
Yeah, really. Just finally, there's been a bit of a drop in the share price recently. Is that worrying you at all?
Oh, with biotech, we are used to dramatic volatility, especially when companies have small market caps, relatively small market caps. The volatility is very synonymous, but we're very happy with increased volume that we've gotten from the NASDAQ listing. We have a very robust pipeline. We have two drugs going into phase two in the clinic, one drug going into phase 2B for liver cancer. We have a breast cancer drug, which we think is exceptional. It's a breast cancer, diagnostic test, which we believe is world class. And of course, we have our COVID project, which has become one of our biggest priorities because of the pandemic emergency, which we believe has a unique way of getting immediate relief to patients that could die from lung failure.
Well, Gabriele, really appreciate your time tonight. Thanks very much indeed, and for your frank, open discussion. Really good to see you.
Thank you for having me, Andrew.
And thanks everybody for watching. I mean, we've had 800-900 people tune in tonight. So look, appreciate you taking the time. Realize you've had probably had other places to be and other people to talk to, but it's been much appreciated. planarTECH's Ray Gibbs, S4 Capital's Sir Martin Sorrell, of course, Open Orphan's Cathal Friel, and just now we've heard from Gabriele Cerrone from Tiziana Life Sciences. Now, look, a big event next week. We're expecting to hear from Premier Royal. That'll be a big one. So make sure you tune in this time next week, or a little bit earlier, of course. 6 o'clock next Thursday. Don't forget all these presentations. Should you happen to have missed one of those crucial moments, they'll all be up on the Proactive website. They'll ideally be up a bit later tonight. If not, they'll be up first thing tomorrow, so don't worry about it. Check the website, proactiveinvestors.co.uk. Also, check my Twitter. It's Andrew Scott TV, plus the Proactive Investors Twitter, @proactive_UK. All the details there. And make sure you register for next week's event. And once again, thanks everybody for tonight's involvement. Good to see you. And thanks for your questions. It's been much appreciated. Nice to see you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.